to give you a little speech, and you have to listen to it. I chose a topic to try to say a few things about neutrinos. And I worked on neutrinos some fraction of my life. I know some things about them, but many of you know everything which I know. And I thought, nevertheless, the neutrinos are sort of a romantic subject. Some people think they're very special particles, especially those not in physics. So this is, if the people here, the ministers who are not daily following physics, then I hope maybe there will be something there that will be some pleasure for them. So let me try to say a few words about neutrinos.
For hydrogen bombs. So I could have done without the hydrogen bombs, but the experiment was the following. The neutrinos from this pile, which there were enough of them to make an interaction now and then in water, they interacted with just the protons in the inverse process of beta decay. Just the neutrino was absorbed by the proton, out came a positron and neutron, and they absorbed both the neutron and the positron. The positron, it goes a little ways in this material and catches an electron, and finally they annihilate against just a bruised photon which had been emitted. That happens immediately. But the neutron, it wanders around and slows down. It takes it a microsecond or two to do this, and eventually gets absorbed in some cadmium which they have in there, and produces an excited cadmium, which again makes gamma rays, which are seen. And so the delay coincidence of the second gamma ray becomes the first. And that shows this hypothesis on phenol, that was a direct detection in the right amount. If I had more time, this was the occasion, I could make a very happy remark here. So let me now go to neutrinos at higher energy. These neutrinos were neutrinos from the decay of heavy nuclei, and in fact, antineutrinos, and which were detected by Reines and Kalman. We now go to 1962 to an experiment at Brookhaven, and the reason we have to go to 1962 is because this experiment wouldn't have been possible before. The evolution of accelerators after the war was very rapid, but the energy increased very rapidly, and in 1962 there was an accelerator at Brookhaven Laboratory which had enough energy to produce neutrinos with sufficient intensity and sufficiently collimated in the forward direction so you could imagine to do experiments with the neutrinos and see what these neutrinos do in that. But the neutrinos are produced in reactions which are the following. The protons in the accelerator, they strike some target, which I think it was beryllium in that experiment, and out come a lot of particles. The ones that interest us are, these are now unstable particles, pions and kaons. And the pions and kaons are the ones which enter here because they decay over the travel some meters or some tens of meters and decay into muons, both of them, and neutrinos. So this produces neutrinos, and because these particles are going in the forward direction or in a certain direction, the neutrinos, they follow that to some extent. So you produce a collimated beam of neutrinos of a certain intensity. What's done here, this is the accelerator, you see the ring in which the protons are contained. They allow the start of power here, and here is a region with nothing in it, in which the secondaries which are produced have a chance to decay and produce neutrinos. And then there's a massive field which is made of iron, which was about 10 meters thick, which came from a battleship. Our group was based at Nevis Cyclotron Lab. At Nevis Cyclotron Lab, we had a contract from the US Navy. They supported this work. They didn't expect us to make weapons for them. They just supported basic research. And when we needed things like trucks and so on, we got old Navy trucks, and we also got old Navy battleships for shielding. And then in here was a detector here. The detector consisted of 10 1-ton modules. You needed a lot of matter to let the neutrinos interact, to have some chance of having some interact. And the same matter also had to serve as detector, because you couldn't let them interact one place and then hope to see them some other place. And so this matter was made of aluminum plates, spaced each one 2.5 centimeters. Our American consul will know that that's an inch to an inch thick, and in between there's a little gap. And you could make that gap spark if a particle goes through it. And so you see these sparks, and you could see what comes out. At least you could see the sparks produced by them. And the these were photographs. And what was seen, let's see. Yes. Let me remind you that these neutrinos are produced in conjunction with a muon. They're produced by in pile decay and tail decay, a different process than the neutrinos produced in a pile. And what turned out is they also make different things. The different kinds of neutrinos. That was the result of that experiment. It was not completely unanticipated. There were theoretical problems which could be understood if one imagined the neutrinos to be different. And this is what was seen here. Is we made a party afterwards. This is what we sent around to invite people to the party. Oh, but my God, you cannot see it. There's no way of dimming these lights. It is the God, as the good Lord is saying. So you cannot see it.
No, we have it.
Okay. And anyway, there's a picture of one of these events in these spark chambers, and in it, if you could see it, there would be basically a penetrating attack. And you can see from the fact that it's penetrating that it's a muon. So this neutrino is producing a muon. The other things which are produced are not very important. The result of the experiment was over here. You can see a little bit the apparatus. I hope you can see that a little bit. These are the 10 spark chamber modules. All of the events basically have such a muon coming out. And if the neutrinos had not been different, if they had been the same, then at least half of them would have had electrons coming out. So this was really convincing that neutrinos are of different sorts, and of course that fits into the picture now that we have of having families of particles. This was just the second family of neutrinos. Now, I want this was the first high-energy neutrino experiment, as you already heard from Enrique. The neutrino beams have been used extensively to study particle physics since that time. Here's a paper by a group at CERN, essentially based at the experiment was started in Paris at the École Polytechnique, and they constructed a father chamber called Garbinet. And I have a nice picture from that experiment, but you will not be able to see it either. That's really a picture. And they found something which is just extremely important. They found a new interaction of a new component of the weak interaction called nuclear carbon, which was predicted by that theory which emerged about 1970. You notice this experiment was 1973. In 1970, the electroweak theory, which was extremely beautiful theoretically, was predicted, but was postulated. But all the experiments which were in hand were equally well explained by the simple theory of families. And you needed some way of gaining confidence in the new theory. The theory predicted new things, and we new things were basically this neutral front, which was seen in this experiment in 1973, and this was the importance of the experiment. It showed not only that there are neutral fronts, but in showing that there are neutral fronts, it established an extremely big step forward in our understanding of particle physics. The first, I mean, CERN by that time was 20 years old. It was the first really fundamental discovery. Very important thing here, this picture, I hope you can see. This is the inside of this publishing where we got made at Ecole Polytechnique. It was when these people got out of it, it was filled with a heavy liquid with freon. It was 4 meters long and 2 meters in diameter. And you could see particle tracks as follows. I should mention that this was 1973, as I said, already did. But the first copper chamber was made now about 20 years before, and they were so big, so this was bigger. And they found events in which there was no muon. They called them muonless events. And so they could not be the normal current. That was just the evidence for neutral fronts. Ah, this one can see a little bit better. This is a picture of the copper chamber. Part of it. The neutrinos were coming in this way. Of course, you don't see the neutrinos, but here something starts. There's a track which starts and then does something here. And I won't explain all of it, but it's clearly a K plus meson, which is interacting here with the freon, and then finally decaying. And here, there's nothing, but you can see these pair of tracks is called a D. This was a lambda particle, an excited, particle heavier than the proton, which was produced also here and decayed at this point here, well-known particle. So here you saw what was coming out, there was no muon. This is a muonless event. This event by itself would, if there were no other complications, could just demonstrate. That's what they saw, a few hundred of those events, and that established this theory, which was the electroweak theory. It was a very important event at the time. And I like to remember it. I think it was just a very big contribution. Now, this was in the public paper. They were, at that time, the preferred tool for this kind of physics. But as time went on, it was possible to make neutrino experiments better by using electronic detectors. And this is the detector which already Enrique talked about at CERN. It was built in the middle 70s, which consisted of modules weighing each one of them something like 50 tons, and there were 20 of them strung along, in which neutrinos could interact, and you could see what comes up. This was a detector which was then much heavier, and altogether things had advanced. The accelerator was had a higher energy by a factor of 10, and this had for neutrino experiments a very important result, because not only do the neutrino, the probability of making an event go up with the energy, but also the beams become more collimated because of the velocity of the particles which create them. And in this experiment we saw millions of events, whereas in the first experiment we saw a few tens. And here you see such an event. This is the detector strung out along here. And you see the energy which is released immediately in the event, which the neutrino produced. And here you see a muon going up, it's a penetrating particle, you see it going along. It's focused by the magnetic field, it's always focused to the center. And you measure the energy of the muon by just taking the curvature of that. You see it in three projections. So this is a typical neutrino event which was seen in this detector, millions of them. And they were used extensively to study something, also properties of the weak interaction, but chiefly properties of the nucleon. By 1970s, in the early 70s, it was seen as black,
that the proton and the neutron, the nucleon, are not animated, that they have in them things we now call quarks. They are composites of the quarks which I had in my first transparency. And the quark structure of these nucleons could be investigated, maybe best with these neutrinos, but certainly very well with neutrinos. Neutrinos are good for this because they just penetrate inside the nucleon, and you can see what's inside to some extent. And so there were there's a large amount of experimental information which allowed you to understand this quark structure model of the nucleon better and gain confidence in it. And there was finally one experiment which maybe was more qualitatively useful, and that was to see to have some proof of a theory which came along. By 1973 also came along a theory of the strong interaction. This is the first, I've been in particle physics for a very long time, the first time we had a theory of strong interaction. It was a bit accident to them. It was called quantum chromodynamics, invented by, there's always many people involved. And it had many good theoretical features, and it was not easy to come to grips with the theory at the time in a quantitative way, to take quantitative predictions of the theory and compare them with experiments. And the first one of these was this scattering of this was called heat inelastic scattering of electrons, in particular of the neutrino. What is shown here is the probability of scattering cross-section as a function of the momentum transfer squared in the reaction. Now, if the in the simple, naive model of quarks in nucleons, this would be independent. This was the first discovery of Flatwell, that this thing here should be independent of momentum transfer. It should be just flat. Each one of those should be, say, like this one. This one here, which is flat going across. Or this one here. That was called scale. But the small variations expected from this, at the large x, I don't want to say what x is, and the small x, which are predicted by that theory. And these experiments, and these were not so easy to see, but these neutrino experiments, one could for the first time verify this new quantum chromodynamic theory, and that was a big use of this. Now, I'm going through a lot of things, maybe I should stop. Let me skip this. Neutrinos played a role at CERN. I'll skip this one here. Let me go to astrophysics. Maybe I'll just show this thing here. No. I will show it. One of the, as Enrique already mentioned, at the new LEP collider at CERN, right early on, we're able to make a really qualitatively new statement, which was about the number of these families. I told you before that there were three, but it's not obvious that there should be three. The theory doesn't tell you how many families there should be. And it was possible that LEP, and also with a bit of help from neutrinos, to convince yourself that there can't be any other families. And the argument is that in the decay of the Z particle, which is made in these electron-positron collisions, all the things which they decay into can contribute to this decay and make the decay more broad. That is, it gives some energy width to the decay probability. And this depends on all the channels in which it can decay. Now, if there are higher mass quarks or charged leptons, then this Z, which is decaying, which has a mass of 90 GeV, wouldn't have enough energy to produce these. But since these neutrinos are very light,
it would make good phenols, and that would contribute to decay. And you can see the expected distribution in the probability of making these Zs with heat energy, which is depending on the number of families of neutrinos. You can see very clearly there are only three neutrino families. This was an important event, and it's in this case possible not because the neutrinos are not interacting, but possible because the neutrinos have very little mass. Now let me just say a few words about neutrinos in astrophysics. The chief interest of neutrinos in astrophysics, well, not all a bit different. People have been for a long time trying to see neutrinos produced in the sun. In the sun, the energy is produced by converting hydrogen into helium in general, and the two neutrinos which come out with that. They carry only a small fraction of the energy, only about 2%, something like that. But they at least get out right from the center. So the heat which is otherwise produced, it takes a million years for it to get out. And the neutrinos, they come out in directly without interacting for a few seconds. And it takes them 7 minutes to get to the Earth, just the velocity of light. And people have tried to look for these neutrinos, but just because they interact very little, and these especially have very little energy, so the interaction is even less, they are very hard to detect. Davis was the first one to do an experiment, started in 1970, down in a gold mine, Homestead, somewhere in the United States. And he looked for, he had a tank full of chlorine, or several tanks of chlorine, altogether 133 tons of chlorine. And this picks up a neutrino sometimes, converts itself to an argon 37, which is radioactive, with a lifetime of about 30 days, something like that, and can then be observed in its decay. You have to fish out that atom of argon out of this tank of chlorine, and what they finally manage to do is fish out about 0.4 of them per day, the 0.4 atoms per day out of these tons of chlorine, and this in fact was a very important result. They could say that in fact, if there are, this has been going on now for 20 years, that only a third as many as they expect to see. And the solar model, the model of energy production in the sun, because you can calibrate by how much energy comes out, is pretty well known. And so a factor of three isn't easy. So that was a shock. It was more or less confirmed that completely no real significance is different, but they all are less in the solar model. Now, these, well, these experiments are extremely hard, and they may be wrong, but still I want to say a few words about them. Now, just recently, the experiment, these two experiments, they look only at the highest energy, still very low energy, the highest energy neutrinos produced in the sun, and there are very few of those, and they're not really representative of what goes on in the sun. But the real reaction which is represented is just two protons hitting each other, making a deuterium and a neutrino. And these are very high-energy neutrinos, and it's now possible to look for them in gallium. There are two of these gallium experiments. One is a European one, but that has not yet reported results. There's rumor to have a result. But there's an American-Russian one, which is in the Soviet Union, has published the results. And they see less than about half of the solar model. But this is now more serious from the point of view. They really see the neutrinos which are the dominant neutrinos. But the experiment has only been going a short time. They are more likely to be wrong than the others. And I only mention it because you can see from this that you can A, try to learn about the sun using these neutrinos. But you can also imagine that maybe you learn about neutrinos from those neutrinos which are produced in the sun, because the conditions in the sun are very different from the conditions that we can reproduce in the laboratory. And these neutrinos, they have to first of all go through the sun. And there are theories in which these neutrinos may be fewer, because in going through the sun, they oscillate from being electron neutrinos, which they started out with, now coming out really as muon neutrinos, which would not be seen. And so the reason why we see so few is because, in fact, there are really very interesting things going on as a neutrino goes through the the sun, and we can learn something about properties of particles. And for instance, if this were really the explanation, then you would know that the neutrino masses have to be of the order of about a billionth of an electron mass. It can be a bit bigger, a bit less, but it has to be of the order of that. And you know, the authors know that they have to admit that they can convert one from the other, they can oscillate from one to the other. So this is just not the end of the story, but it's to show that in astrophysics, A, these properties of the particles are important, and B, the you can also learn about particles. And another example, really the most, this one is really lovely, is a supernova in 1987. There was a supernova which was, I think, in the galaxy which is closest to our present one, to our own galaxy, the 1987 supernova. And in that supernova, this really was, of course, studied very much by all kinds of detectors, all kinds of radiation. But the thing which was really fantastic is that you could see neutrinos from that supernova. And these supernova, they, you know what they are, the a star is coming to the end of its burning of the hydrogen, there's no longer enough heat generated to keep the star big, it collapses gravitationally, and in this gravitational collapse, there's a lot of heat generated. So the thing gets hot, and you get to a temperature which corresponds to of the order of now not in, in degrees, but in order of these units of energy here, 10 MeV, which is must be about 1,000 times hotter than the inside of the sun. Somebody help me. So that order. But the sun is a few kilojoules. Okay. It's really a pretty hot.
So yeah.
But
10
is 10 MeV.
10 MeV times the electron volt. And
okay. So it's even more. So it's really hot. And this heat is then carried not only by all the by photons and so on, but also by neutrinos. Neutrinos are generated in this heat, and it's those neutrinos which cool the supernova. The supernova doesn't stay hot very long because the neutrinos which are produced and they're produced as long as this thing is hot. So things just go right through. And the thing cools down, it collapses, I think, in something like a fraction of a second. And it cools down in 10 seconds. 10 seconds, the thing is over. That's for such a big thing, 10 seconds. Because all of that energy is getting out with neutrinos. And some of these neutrinos were seen in that same Japanese Kamiokande experiment. Kamiokande experiment. This water tank. And also in a water tank similar in the United States called IMD. And they saw these neutrinos, each one of them saw maybe half a dozen or a dozen of these neutrinos. And we learned a lot from those. We learned how they're distributed in time, so we could confirm that the thing is all over within 10 seconds. We could see the energy distribution, not very well, but to some extent we could see the overall rate. And from this came, let me show you, experimental data, which there are the limits. So this is what they saw. Yeah, I mean, the upper lip is not what they saw. The upper picture, I just took it out of a paper, which I love, it's so beautiful. The supernova have all kinds of structure, you see. A double echo, and you see the structure here, thing. But this is not what I'm talking about. I'm talking about the thing below, where you see the number of these is a function of time, and this is 10 seconds, you see. And the upper one is one of these experiments, the lower one is the other one, and here the energies which they saw these experiments have different thresholds. They only see the very highest energy with respect to the energy which is produced in the supernova with respect to the temperature of the supernova. So these handful of events were really a miracle. These experiments were not made with checklists, but they realized that they might be able to detect them. And they were there when it happened. And you learn a few things about neutrino just from this. You learn about the supernova, yes, because everything clicked to the model, but you also learn about neutrinos because in coming here all at the same time, the mass had to be smaller than a certain amount. In being able to come out, the magnetic moment had to be smaller than a certain amount, the electric charge had to be smaller than a certain amount. Fingers in my hand. So yeah, these things are not so important, but this, they're not surprising at any, this is what we learned. So this is to just show a little bit of this, which is something which is very much appreciated these days, this interrelationship between what we learn in astrophysics and what we learn in the laboratory. I mentioned only one thing, I won't show any one slide. In the, you learn also about neutrinos in the, from the Big Bang. The neutrinos play a big role in the Big Bang in the same way as a method of energy transfer. And the evolution of the Big Bang is modified by the neutrinos, which are in equilibrium to the temperature, and the temperature goes down. In a certain moment, they decouple because the interaction is no longer strong enough. And the neutrinos fly out and contribute to the cooling of the Big Bang and modify the conditions that at the time at which the elements are formed. And so by looking at how many, what the ratio is between helium atoms and hydrogen atoms in the interstellar space, you can go back to the early days of the Big Bang and argue about the conditions. And people, even before we argued at length, as I showed you, that there should be just three families, people thought from astrophysical evidence there shouldn't be more than four at least, or something like that, or less than two. It was the question of these families play a big role in the Big Bang. There's another role which neutrinos may play, but I don't know. And then about the Big Bang, you can be sure they play a big role. But the they may be dark matter. You know that, well, at least we're told by our astrophysics colleagues that most of the matter around us is not stuff that we see, it's dark. But we don't know what this dark matter is. And it's conceivable that neutrinos with a mass of the order of 20 electron volts of that sort, surrounded by what you know about the dark matter, could possibly be this dark matter, but this no one knows. It's just to impress you with how important neutrinos are. They may be almost all the matter around us, because this dark matter is almost all there. So let me end by thanking you all for participating at the glorification of Jack Steinberg.